Jeff Kerr, CBS Sports. As we take a look at some NFL news and notes, the Eagles making some news today as, man, an interesting signing. Let's bring Jeff Kerr into the conversation, get his initial reaction. Howie Roseman goes out and gets the all-time sack leader in Washington football history, Jeff. They bring in Ryan Kerrigan. Kind of an interesting signing. What's the message?
I'll tell you what, Mike. I don't know if there's an actual message involved. It's just the Eagles getting a player that is very talented to add to their already strong defensive front. That's how I look at it. I mean, look, they didn't need to add Ryan Kerrigan, but they had an opportunity to get a good player who can play in a part-time role for them. And, you know, pretty much that's it. I mean, you can put Ryan Kerrigan on the outside now. You can move Brandon Graham on the inside. Think of this, Mike. You can have a front four of Ryan Kerrigan, Brandon Graham, Fletcher Cox, Derek Barnett / Josh Sweat. I mean, that's a pretty good pass rush.
You're absolutely right. I was talking about that earlier, is that, you know, I'm interested to get your take, Jeff, on how much gas Kerrigan has in the tank. I mean, he didn't play a lot last year, still had 5.5 sacks, terrorized the Eagles even last year, won Defensive Player of the Week against them. But I look at Brandon Graham, who's 33, same draft class, and I don't think people look at him as a guy who's out of gas. So is Kerrigan out of gas, or did he just have two players that were young and very talented in front of him?
I think what Washington did was, when they drafted Chase Young, I think that signaled the end of Ryan Kerrigan. And ultimately, Chase Young is going to be a stud in this league. You drafted him number two overall pick, and he did not disappoint. He was Rookie of the Year last year for a reason. It's going to get even better. So Ryan Kerrigan's snaps were going to be diminished no matter what. They got a gem in the draft with Montez Sweat, who was drafted after Andre Dillard, let me mind you, in 2019. So, again, you know, Montez Sweat, he's a stud on the edge. You got Jonathan Allen. You got De'Ron Payne. Ryan Kerrigan was more of a luxury for them, and they could afford to play him, you know, 38% of the snaps or whatever it was last year. And they used Ryan Kerrigan to the best of their ability last year. And look, I'm sure Ryan Kerrigan knew the writing on the wall. I didn't think his stats diminished by any means, depending on how much he played. You know, he was much more productive than, say, a Vinnie Curry was last year for the Eagles, and they're the same age. So to me, it was just more of, there were too many, there wasn't enough vacancy at the end. I guess that's how I would word it. And, you know, Ryan Kerrigan was a free agent. I was shocked that it was this long, but I don't think teams wanted to give up a compensatory pick for a part-time player like Ryan Kerrigan, which is what he is at this point in his career. And I got to give the Eagles credit. They pounced on it. You know, I think there were a lot of teams interested in him, but at the end of the day, Ryan Kerrigan seemed to want to stay in the NFC East, and kudos to the Eagles for bringing him in.
Well, he also, you know, not only did he want to stay in the NFC East, it was the fact that he looked at, they rotate their ends, they're going to rotate the ends, and there's not a lot of depth here. I mean, they needed to bring in another guy, because after Josh Sweat, you know, and obviously Barnett and Graham, there's not a whole heck of a lot with NFL experience. So Kerrigan looked at it as a way that, hey, I'm not only going to play, I'm going to get some, have a real role on this team.
Yeah, and Jannard Avery's basically transitioning to linebacker now. So, you know, he was out. I thought he was a solid depth piece, and maybe the Eagles do have him rush the passer a bit. But again, if he's changing positions, you're going to need someone in there. But look, bringing in a guy like Ryan Kerrigan, all of a sudden you have tons of depth at him at defensive end. You're absolutely right, Mike. You know, outside of Josh Sweat, there wasn't much there. And if one guy gets hurt, Eagles are pretty much done for. I mean, there wasn't like a what was the third round pick from the other year, from the Texans? I'm forgetting his name. I'm drawing a blank on it.
Who, Philadelphia?
Yeah, on Philadelphia. He was a fourth third round pick of the Texans. He was there last year. He got cut. It's pretty productive for them. I'm drawing a blank on that. I'm going to remember as soon as we get done this segment. But he's gone now. So you didn't have that much depth there. So to me, Ryan Kerrigan is more of a luxury than anything, because they didn't need that. I mean, I'd rather see him get a cornerback at this point. But again, we talked about this before. I think they're going to go to trade route for that. But when you have a talented guy like Ryan Kerrigan available in free agency,
yeah,
you got to improve your team. Look, this isn't the NBA. You just don't try to go 0-16 here.
No, well, look, I think the interesting part here is they got a guy who adds depth to a spot. They need a depth on the defensive line. There's no question. Their starters are fine. Barnett and Graham, fine. Sweat, good rotational guy. They needed another guy. And not only teaches this crew, he's still a guy that can give you production. My question is now, Jeff, if they go out and get a starting level corner, You know, is this a team that we change the perception of?
I don't know if we would change the perception of it, but I think it would fill a lot of holes on this defense that, in my mind, it isn't a bad defense if you look at it. We just look at all the holes, you know, who's going to play cornerback opposite of Darius Slay?
Big question, which is a big question.
Exactly. You know, the linebacking court, we think it's set with Eric Wilson and Alex Singleton. If they play three linebackers, you know, we'll see who gets in that role if they go into a base defense. But they seem to be set at linebacker. They're set at defensive tackle. They're set at defensive end. The defensive front's going to be one of the best in the league regardless. And, you know, again, we have Anthony Harris. At the same time, Rodney McLeod, we'll see how he comes back. He looks like he has something to prove. I think they need depth in that secondary. And, you know, we'll see what happens, but they definitely focused on the draft after the first two rounds on defense. And, you know, honestly, Mike, I think this defense is going to be a little better than a lot of people give it credit for, especially with the pass rush, because it is one of the best pass rushes in the NFL. I just think we're curious of what the secondary is going to be.
Oh, there's no question. They need help at corner. The safety spot, I think Harris can play. We don't know what McLeod's going to be when he comes back. The linebacker should be better. With Wilson, that gives them a better duo than they had last year. And their line, you know, they had the third most sacks in football last year. Adding Kerrigan should add to that. So, yeah, I mean, it's all really, if that safety spot, if Harris is the player he was 2 years ago as opposed to the guy he was last year, and McLeod comes back healthy, it's that other corner spot's the big hole on this team right now. Jeff Kerr is with us looking at Kerrigan. Ryan Kerrigan signs with the Eagles today. What about Zach Ertz? Not there, voluntary, not a big deal. But I guess the question, Jeff, is what is the end of the road? What's the end game here? When do they make a move? When are they forced into doing something here?
Well, it seems like June 1st is going to be, you know, the end-all, be-all here. And the Eagles can designate him as a post-June 1st cut and save $8.5 million of cap space, and then Zach Ertz can do what he wants. I still think the Eagles want a third- or fourth-round pick for this guy. The thing is, I don't know who's going to give up a third- or fourth-round pick for a guy who only had 30 catches for 300 yards last year and just did not look good for the majority of the season. Now, I know he was battling an ankle injury. I think Zach Ertz is a much better player than people give him credit for at this stage in his career. I think he would be better served being on the Eagles and just playing out his contract, then you let him go for nothing. But I understand that he's unhappy. He probably wants to be an Eagle for life, and the Eagles have basically decided, we're not going to do that. You know, we're going to move on from you. But I think this team would be better if Zach Ertz would be here in 2021. I just don't think Zach Ertz wants to make that the case.
So, I mean, he's a no-show. Obviously, that's not a big deal. It's a voluntary thing. He's unhappy with the contract. But if they don't release him and they say, look, we have him under the cap, we're just going to keep him. Does he sit out the whole year? I mean, do you see a stare down to where it gets to that level?
I see, this is what's going to be tough. If he misses mandatory minicamp, he gets fined. If he misses time in training camp, he gets fined. I'm sure the Eagles and him will come to an ultimatum at some point in July if they choose to do that. I think what the Eagles are afraid of ultimately is he's going to go pair up in Indianapolis with his buddy and Carson Wentz. And I think Eagles are looking at the Colts and saying, give us one of those valuable draft picks you have again, and we'll send them to you. We don't have a problem with that. I just don't think the Eagles want to let him go.
Kevin Costner going to jump on the phone and say, I want my picks back?
Yeah, that might be the case. By the way, that's a terrible movie. I don't know how people watch Draft Day. But beside the point there, I honestly think the Eagles would rather just keep the guy. I really do. I just think, look, it's like you said, Mike, we're under the cap. We're a better team with him. We feel we have a chance to compete with him. And maybe, you know, Zach Ertz, I just don't see Zach Ertz as the type of player that's going to hold out. I really don't. This part of the offseason, sure. Mandatory minicamp, I think he shows up if he's still on the team.
Right. I would say for the people out there reading, oh, he didn't show up to this. This isn't a big deal. There's a lot of guys who just decided they're not going to show up to the voluntary stuff. This is a more widespread thing than it has been in the past. Because typically, Jeff, in the past, voluntary workouts, man, you better be there.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, it was voluntary, but it wasn't voluntary. In a way, it still kind of is. But now I think players have a little more say in that. And, you know, I remember when they had the voluntary portion of minicamp, they're like, oh, it's perfect attendance. I'm like, well, yeah, because the coaches were basically making it.
Yeah, exactly.
That now they don't have to be there. If they don't want to be in the NovaCare complex, that's their right. But if they get hurt outside the NovaCare complex, that's where the problems come. That's why players show up, because if they get hurt inside the facility, then, you know, that's on the team's dime. That's not on their dime. So Again, you know, Zach Ertz has every right to do what he wants to do. I have no problem with that. I think when they have mandatory man camp June 8th through 10th, I think he comes.
Frank Reich also speaking, he says, I'm very confident that he has a team around him. You know, he said, I stick my neck out for people I believe in. You know, this is going to I feel like this Wentz-Reich thing, this whole Wentz in Indianapolis thing, is going to be following Wentz around everywhere he goes this year. Is he back or is he broken? Which one is it?
I honestly don't know, to be honest with you. I think he's a broken player right now, but he looked like a broken player last year. He just looked like a guy who just did not want to be in Philadelphia anymore. And I think it got even worse when he got benched, and he probably heard the rumblings from his agent and everybody else, hey, the Colts want you. You know, you should go to the Colts. And, you know, I'm sure I don't want to, you know, get family issues involved, but it seemed like his wife, you know, wanted to go back to the Midwest. And, you know, that's completely fine. I mean, I'm not going to, you know, assume anything here, but it just seemed like the Carson Wentz marriage with the Philadelphia Eagles was on the rocks for the majority of last year, specifically when the Eagles drafted Jalen Hurts, even though Wentz made a bigger deal out of that than what it needed to be. And, you know, you're right, Mike. He's just tied to Frank Reich at this point. And I don't have a problem with that. If he feels that's his best chance of succeeding in the NFL and becoming a Pro Bowl player, more power to him. I hope the Eagles get the first-round pick for him. It seems like, you know, in a way, Frank Reich kind of said the Eagles suck, but he didn't say they sucked. And, you know, that's why Carson Wentz failed. It just seems like no one ever holds Carson Wentz accountable for playing bad. There's always excuses from the fans, the media, where it's the offensive line, where it's the receivers, and that's all true. But Carson Wentz, if he is as good of a player as I thought he was, as you thought he was, as anybody thinks he was, he should have been better than what he was last year, and he just wasn't. So I don't know if he can be fixed. I'm wishing the best for him in Indianapolis. I kind of hope he gets his career back on track. I want to see him do well, and I want to see the Eagles do well.
All right, another interesting – what do you think of this, what Jacksonville's doing with Travis Etienne, making him a wide receiver? I mean, we all said, why would you take a running back in the first round when you already had Robinson, who was 1,400 yards last year as an undrafted? So you take a running back. Well, they don't plan on using him at running back. Apparently, he's going to play wide receiver, it looks like.
I think Urban Meyer is – he kind of tipped his hand a little bit on what he was going to do with Travis Etienne on draft weekend, because he goes, look, we view him as a third down running back. And they're like, oh, okay, that makes sense, because now you pair him – you know, you use James Robinson on the heavy downs and you use Travis Etienne in the passing game. And I think that's what it is. I think he's putting him at wide receiver, you know, because this is the way the running back position is going in the NFL. They have a short shelf life to begin with. And Urban Meyer, in at least in my opinion, is just using Etienne in the best way he can. And, you know, if you're going to line him up in the slot, you're going to line him up on the outside and use his abilities to catch the football to your advantage, then do that. Look, this is the thing with Travis Etienne. He led the ACC in receiving yards in each of the last 2 years. He led the ACC in receiving yards for running backs, I should say, you know, over the last 2 years. And I got to give him credit for that. Look, he's using the guy to his advantage. He wants to see him and James Robinson on the football field. And this is the best way to do it. You have Travis Etienne under a rookie contract. When it's James Robinson's time to go, you know, maybe Jacksonville moves on from him, or maybe Urban Meyer's gone by then. Then you make Travis Etienne the running back one. He's going to get his carries. He's going to get his yards. But he's going to get his touches. It's just going to be in a variety of different ways.
Do you buy anything that Matt Nagy's selling as Andy Dalton is his starter?
No, he is not. I'm sorry. He is not QB1. The Bears are foolish. It's Justin Fields. Hey, Justin Fields has to be starting for this football team week one. Justin Fields should be Andy Dalton out for this starting job. He can probably be him out for the starting job with his left hand. I'm dead serious about that. I don't know what the love affair is with Andy Dalton. I never got it. I can't believe the guy actually made 3 Pro Bowls as a quarterback. To me, he's a good, you know, he's a decent starter. He's a game manager. If the Bears wanted to make him the quarterback this year and not have Justin Fields on their roster, fine. You know, you're asking yourself to go 6-10, 7-9. I'm sorry, 6-11, 7-10. I got to get the 17-game schedule right here.
Yeah.
But Justin Fields, I think you are a much better football team because he can scramble. He can run. He can throw on the run. He can throw in the pocket. Al Robinson and Darnell Mooney are going to shine with this guy. David Montgomery emerged as one of the best running backs in football last year, especially toward the last half of the year. And that was with Mitchell Trubisky running the football around and being the quarterback of the Chicago Bears. What's he going to do when, you know, Justin Fields is there? Tariq Cohen's back. If this offensive line is better, Chicago's going to be dangerous.
And people forget they made the playoffs last year.
Yeah, exactly. They're going to be better. They're going to compete with Green Bay. And that's what I want to see. I get on the Bears a lot. I make fun of their fans a lot. But they are spot on here. I think they are going to be instantly a better football team with Justin Fields as a starting quarterback.
Do you remember the third round pick?
Ooh, this year?
No, the third round pick that you couldn't remember. Did it hit you? Deshaun Hall.
Deshaun, that's it. You know what? I almost said Dante Hall, and I knew that wasn't right. It started with a D. I said, as soon as I go off the air, I'm going to be like, Deshaun Hall.
Wow. That's what I was saying. After all this, did it come back and hit you again?
Well, you know what I was thinking? Because you said Bears. I was thinking Bears-Giants straight for a second because there was a third-round pick involved in there.
All right. Well, Ryan Kerrigan signs with the Eagles today. There's your Eagles news. They continue to kind of make news even in this offseason. They have the voluntary camps going on right now as well. We'll have more on that. And, of course, Jeff Kerr, like all guests, appeared via the Boardwalk Honda Hotline. All right, Jeff. Good stuff, man.
Thanks for having me on, Micah. Busy Monday, but I wouldn't have it any other way.